This is Ham Radio Now, episode 207. And I am turning to something completely different. It's all ham radio, right? We're going to look at the 2015 TAPR Forum at the Dayton Hamvention. And in honor of TAPR, I'm listening to 14236, the frequency that might normally be used for digital voice on 20 meters for free DV. I'm not hearing any free DV signals. Back there now, just some sideband folks off on the edge. Oh, yeah, I still have my SM1000 that I have not yet hooked up to play with. I've been busy doing all that DX stuff. So this is going to be in two parts, and you're looking at part one right now, because the TAPR Forum ran a little over 90 minutes, and I'm going to spend a little bit of time here, so we'll split things up somewhat arbitrarily. Just the main reason for doing that is to keep the file size somewhat reasonable and the compression somewhat reasonable, the video compression. So we'll do this as a part one and a part two. So I'll tell you what, I'm going to go to Steve Bible here and let him tell you what's coming up in the TAPR Forum.
Okay, so then I'm going to segue into the forum here and turn it over to Scotty. So Scotty's given me about 10 minutes, and then we want to let Steve Ford come up and put a pitch for writing some articles. And then next up is going to be the Hamnet Mesh. At 10 o'clock, we'll have the high-speed IP radio. At 10:25, the White Box Project. 10:50, spectrum monitoring. And then we'll wrap up at 11:15 and then allow you to go out there and spend your money. Okay?
Okay. You'll hear that again. You don't need to have taken notes. You'll hear that again in just a minute. So let's see what else. I played the frequency and we don't need to do that. Anything showed up yet? Anything yet? Nope. Still a couple sideband folks sitting there on the side. But I do have something that I need to do that I've been kind of waiting for this opportunity to do, so I'm a little bit late in taking care of this, and that is launching the Kickstarter for the 2015 Digital Communications Conference, ARL and TAPR DCC, that is going to be coming up in early-ish October in, I don't have the dates here, in the Chicago area. So I haven't done this yet. And this is live. We are actually doing it. The project was accepted some time ago. And I ended up spending a lot more time doing the DX stuff. And there's still one more program from that to go. So the one on the de-expedition to Iran. I think you'll find that interesting. And still working on that. But not quite ready. So we'll do this. And I need to get the Kickstarter launched. So this is live. Continue to launch. Let's see. Yes, ready to launch. Some reminders. The funding goal is $10,000. It will end July 31st at 11:59 p.m. And let's see. Yeah, some of my instructions and stuff like that. Okay, so launch project now. I think I got to tell it. I have read these important reminders. I've been through this many times now. Did it work? The project has launched. Drum roll. And, okay, so the countdown begins. And there we go. 54 days to go. Nobody's pledged anything yet. Well, that's disappointing. What's taking you guys so long? A couple things about the Kickstarter that before we get onto we're in the right audience now. We got the TAPR audience watching this. A couple things about the Kickstarter. It's got 20? Did I really do $2,500 corporate level reward backer positions? I don't know. I really don't expect we're going to fill out all those, but I thought, why not? We'll put them in there. That if all of those get filled, that covers the whole $10,000. I don't expect that to be the case, and I expect you guys as individuals to come up with a substantial portion of it, as you have in the past, around half. But to find those corporate backers, I need your help. What I'm thinking of is mid to small ham radio businesses, or any business that would like the attention of you technically minded ham radio operators and can afford to put $500 in there. And the video on the Kickstarter explains what they get for that. But it's basically me sitting at the top of the program talking about them for 15 to 30 seconds. And if we get more than five or six of them, I'll do four or five in any given program. And so if we've got all 20 filled, then I'll do five in one program, another five in the next program, five more, then five more. So they'll be in every fourth program for $500. And there's about 16 total regular 45-minute talks, and then one big lead-in at the head of the Sunday seminar. Maybe since I'm only going to do that once, maybe I'll get through everybody as a wrap-up on that one. And then there's the banquet. So there's approximately 18 opportunities to pitch people. It's about the only advertising you'll ever see here on Ham Radio Now. Everything else is you guys stuffing money in Arvin, which has still got the $50 that I collected at Dayton, several $50 bills that I collected at Dayton from you. Things are kind of awesome these days. I'm not getting rich. No, don't worry about that. But it's very satisfying. Okay, so the Kickstarter's launched, and once again, I need your help in identifying those businesses, and you can just tell me who you think might be a good prospect, and if you can come up with some contact information, that would be great. But if you know somebody, especially if you know somebody, and they are probably not familiar with the conference, and probably not familiar with Ham Radio Now, but if you can make that connection and say, here's a worthwhile cause to get these programs on the air and to associate your name with them and to get you a little bit of publicity. I am not and never would promise that they're going to get their money's worth in terms of direct sales. I have no idea whether that's the case. That's what we need. I don't know if it's good for them. I'm assuming they can decide if it's good for them or not. But that's what we need to be able to put the programs on the air. I am looking forward to heading back to my old hometown, Chicago, and seeing the DCC and getting it on video and getting it out there for you toward the end of this year. So that's the Kickstarter, and it is on its way, and so is the DCC. So I guess it's time to check out the TAPR Forum at the Dayton Hamvention, and we will head back to, I think it's Scotty who's leading things off. Oh, I did mention Arvin right there. Yeah, might as well, because that's what's paying for this one. HamRadioNow.tv, stop by. And before you spend all your money on the Kickstarter, put in something for Ham Radio Now directly and take care of this program. I'm really begging for cash. I guess I must be hurting more than I thought I was. Yeah, it's like I say, I'm not getting rich. Okay, back to the DCC, and I think here's Scotty.
Okay, we're ready to get started. So if you please take your seats, but leave them in the room. You can borrow them. Anyway, we've got some great speakers for you today. I'm Scotty Cowling, WA2DFI, the forum moderator, and we're going to start out with our illustrious TAPR president, Steve Bible, has a few words for you.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. And welcome to Hamvention 2015. And it's good to see you all here first thing in the morning. The doors open. How many been at the flea market this morning? Any great bargains?
Everywhere.
Everywhere, okay. So there's to everywhere. Okay, good. So what we have in store, we being the TAPR organization, is tonight we have our banquet along with AMSAT, and we'd like to invite you all there. I hope that you've had an opportunity to purchase your banquet tickets ahead of time, because the reason why we do that is we need to be able to give a head count to the banquet facility. Now, we do tend to buy a little extras on that, so you can check with go to the AMSAT booth. So AMSAT then is the storefront for the banquet tickets. And check with the AMSAT booth to see if there's any extras if you've not had an opportunity to purchase some tickets. And we have a really great time there. This year, we're very fortunate to have Michael Osman, and he's going to be talking about how he, as a hacker, has then worked his way into the ham radio hobby. And should be very interesting. Of course, Michael's going to be talking a little bit later about his HackRF project as well, so you get a little bit of Michael this morning. So we hope to all see you at the banquet this evening. Also, wanted to announce the Digital Communications Conference that we do in with the AARRL, and we do this each year, usually around the September timeframe. What's different about this one this year is it snuck itself into the first week of October. And the reason why is it was a hotel availability, and we're going to be in the Chicago area this year, and it will be, as the dates that you see up here, October 9th through 11th. So if you go up to www.tapper.org/DCC, you can see that you can register, and you can also make your hotel reservations right from that link. Highly recommend that you get your hotel reservations in early. There is a block of rooms, and the price is, I believe, $99, so we've got a very good room price. And it's a very nice hotel facility, and yes, they do offer a free shuttle from the airport to the hotel, so you don't have to worry about a rental car or hitching a ride, as it were. There's going to be many different topics there. It's a call for papers, so if you have a project that you would like to talk about at the DCC, submit a paper. And how do you submit the paper? Again, on the DCC website, gives instructions on the paper and the due dates and where to email it in. If you got any questions, let us know. We'd be happy to help you out. And the DCC is always a great time. A lot of technical talks, a lot of demos, Sunday seminar, banquet speaker. So we have it all for you. You come in and we take care of you the entire time. Your entire schedule of fun is already scheduled. You don't have to worry about a thing. Now, sleep is optional, so keep that in mind. So what has TAPR been up to with respect to kits? We do have a new kit that we're introducing at the TAPR booth this year, and this is the totally awesome switch that you see here. And of course, we learned the totally awesome from Tom Clark, because Tom Clark is totally awesome. And so we've carried on that tradition. So this is one that NAUR has developed, and as we in the shack now need to be able to transfer signals from one place to another, here's kind of a crossbar switch. So come by the booth and talk with John and learn if this is something that you need for your shack. They also make really great Christmas stocking stuffers. So make sure that you get a couple for your nieces and nephews. You never know how many RF switches your nieces and nephews need, okay? The TAPR booth is in the hall. It's in the same hall that the AARRL is, and we're right next to Caddy Corner from the AMSAT booth, so it should be pretty easy to find us there. Come and see all of these demos that are going to be at the booth right now. Number one, we need you to renew your membership while you're there. Come by and see the task demo. Come by and see the SDR stick. Come by and also see the HP SDR demos and the HackRF. So Michael Osman's got his HackRF set up there as well. So we got a lot of things to show off. So come by, see what we've got going. And then we're always willing to take on your projects. If you've got something to show at Hamventions in the future, let us know and we can get your projects displayed there as well. So this is gets us into the TAPR forum, but I want to back up to the DCC, and I want to put in a plug for Gary Pierce. Gary's over here waving, and we want to give him a little hand because he's been really phenomenal at not only video recording the DCC talks, but he does an incredible job of editing. And if ever you've goofed off with video editing software, you're going to know that that takes tens of thousands of hours to do. And Gary's got an uncanny knack for it. And so we're very fortunate for Gary to be able to record the technical sessions and then get those up on the internet for all to enjoy. Now, for the past 3 years it's been, Gary has put up a Kickstarter program to help fund his trips and his expenses for doing this work. And he's been successful for 3 years of getting the funding. So Gary informs us that he's going to set up his Kickstarter program here right after Hamvention for funding his video recording and editing of the DCC in Chicago, October 2015. So we want to thank him for it, but we also want to encourage you all to help pitch in to the Kickstarter program so that we can get these programs on the internet. I think by getting the videos on the internet, which today we learn everything through YouTube, don't we? Yeah. If you need to learn something, it's up on YouTube. And this gets this work out to a greater audience. Now, we want you to join us there because it's a phenomenal time and you get to rub shoulders with some of the ham radio greats. And for those that are unable to for work or home or obligation, then there's always up on the internet to see. And we always get a lot of really great comments for that. Scotty, did I cover everything? Okay, so then I'm going to segue into the forum here and turn it over to Scotty. So Scotty's given me about 10 minutes, and then we want to let Steve Ford come up and put a pitch for writing some articles. And then next up is going to be the Hamnet Mesh. At 10 o'clock, we'll have the high-speed IP radio. At 10:25, the White Box Project. 10:50, spectrum monitoring. And then we'll wrap up at 11:15 and then allow you to go out there and spend your money. Okay? Enjoy.
Okay, now everybody got a pen? You got to write this down. He was done early. So next up, I'd like to welcome Steve Ford from ARL. He's the QST editor, and I'm sure lots of other jobs that you do there. And he has a few words for us. So here's Steve.
And I will not exceed. I will finish early. Well, thank you. I'm glad to see a packed house here. In case I haven't met some of you, again, I'm Steve Ford. I'm WB at IMY. I'm the editor-in-chief of QST Magazine and also the ARRL Publications Manager, which just means I'm in charge of all the paper and everything else that that we put out. And Scott is right. I'm here to hopefully solicit, well, articles and some other things from you. We are always in need of material for various publications. Chief among them, obviously, is QST Magazine. We have a good flow of material, but we can always certainly use more. And in case you're interested or if it makes a difference, we do pay for articles for QST. We pay $65 per published page, and we pay quickly too. as soon as the issue goes to the printer, which is printed out in Pontiac, Illinois, and we are looking for, and we'll consider at least almost anything for QST. We have in case it's of interest, we have what amounts to a semi-anonymous peer review process. If you submit an article, it goes to a somewhat clandestine group of engineers and some scientists scattered around the country and around the world, and I wouldn't be surprised if a few are lurking here. They evaluate the articles, our editorial department looks at them in terms of writing and so on, and what our needs are editorially, and then we pick the articles that we want to accept. Don't worry if you feel that your writing isn't up to snuff, or if English is not your first language, or if you don't think that you have the chops to draw schematics or diagrams. We handle all of that. We have a team of editors who will polish your writing. We have a graphics staff. We've had people submit drawings literally, really, on just paper with pencil. And they will take that and render it into whatever is necessary. So don't let that hold you back. In addition to QST, though, we also have QEX. And QEX is more technical than QST is. The one advantage of writing for QEX, by the way, is QST's lead time tends to be somewhat long because we have a lot of articles in the queue. Right now, as I stand here, we have about 8 months worth of material. In other words, all the issues out for the next 8 months are full. QEX, not so much. QEX, they don't quite go hand to mouth, but they have a much, much shorter turnaround than we do, we being the QST staff. Also, and this might not occur to you right away, but don't forget NCJ, the National Contest Journal. And that may seem odd, especially to this audience, but before you dismiss NCJ as just a contesters magazine, these same contesters are very much into technology, software, station, automation, and so on. And the NCJ team is always looking for good technical articles, so don't leave them out of it. Steve mentioned the Digital Communications Conference, the proceedings. We put together the proceedings, and we are always, always looking for material. And the door is virtually wide open for that. You send us something that is halfway sane, and chances are it will go into the proceedings. We make it easy for you. We publish exactly what you send us. It doesn't go through the editorial teams and all that, so the turnaround is very rapid. In addition, even though we would love to have you at the DCC, of course, you don't have to be there to have your paper published in the proceedings. So don't let that hold you back. The deadline date, I don't remember exactly. August 17th, thank you. And my assistant back at headquarters, her name is Maddie Weinberg. And the reason I mention her, it's a real easy email address to remember, M-A-T-Y, Matty, at ARRL.org, not net, but O-R-G. And if you have questions about getting into the proceedings, a paper to submit, whatever, she is your person. Also, and last but not least, we are also, the league, very much in the market for new books. And books are, you know, I'll be the first to admit, are a bit of a challenge. I've written a number of them myself. They take time. They take a fair amount of work on everyone's part. But for reasons that escape me, it's getting harder and harder to find good quality books. And I can't write all of them. I'm writing one now, but I would much rather you wrote them, frankly. And we, again, do pay for books. The pay varies on the size of the book and the type of the book and so on. But, without getting into specifics, it's enough that, you could buy a couple of very nice transceivers with it. Let's put it that way. If you have an idea for a book to be considered, it's relatively easy. All you have to do is just send me a proposal, and it's wb8imy@arrl.org. And by a proposal, by the way, I don't mean a multi-page document, but just a single page of how you see this book playing out. What's the topic? If you have some idea of what the chapters might contain, you might have a list of something like that. If you've written before anything, send us perhaps a sample of what your writing looks like. We do, unlike what I said about QSD and the other magazines, we do have to take writing quality into consideration, because with a book, obviously that's a lot of our time as well as yours. And if somebody is frankly a poor writer, then that's not economically feasible for us to pound that straw into gold and turn it into a book. But that's really all you need, is just a proposal. How big, not physical size, but number of pages, maybe you think the book might be. Sample the writing. Again, send it to me, wb@imy@arrl.org. In terms of what we're looking for, let's see. I would say, how am I doing on time, by the way, Scott?
3 minutes.
Oh, okay, good. Well, I'm doing well. All right. We're looking for anything to do, for example, with software-defined radio, Arduino. We can't get enough for QSD or books about Arduino. You send us an Arduino project, again, that is halfway sane, and our eyes will light up. So anything of that nature. Mesh, again, you name it. So don't hesitate. If you catch me here at Dayton, I'll be happy to give you a business card if you have difficulty remembering my address. And we'd love to see you in print. Thank you. Thanks, Scott.
Thank you. Okay, and Steve finished early too. Great, we're on a roll. Okay, next up we have Bob Dixon and Bill Curtice are going to talk to us about high-speed digital microwave mesh networks. Did I get that right? Okay, close enough. Here's Bill.
Good morning. I thank Scotty and the TAPR organization for allowing us to talk to you today about mesh. This is something that we've been working on for about a year, and we're starting to get excited about it. We'd like to share some of that enthusiasm. I'm going to give a very brief, and I mean brief, description of what mesh is, how it works, how it's deployed, and talk about a few of the applications and possibilities, trying to leave as much possible time as possible for Bob Dixon to give a demonstration. You'll find his demonstration a lot more interesting than what I have to say, but if any of you haven't been into mesh before, you may find this background interesting in just understanding where we're going and why. We have a mesh booth at the end of East Hall on the right-hand side behind the Luzo Tower. When we finish this presentation, I hope that you're left with a lot of questions and issues that you'd like to raise with us. Please come to the mesh booth. We'll be happy to entertain your questions and address your issues at that point. So what's a mesh? A mesh is simply a wireless network, a wireless digital network made up of repeaters. We call them nodes. They operate on microwave frequencies, and their job is to transport digital data, just like the LAN that you might have in your school or factory or business. Not a whole lot difference in terms of performance. They move high-speed digital data required for any kind of application that you might want or use, that you would want to move data for. Each node is based on using typically either a Linksys wireless router or commercial equipment such as the Ubiquiti line of access points that I've shown here. We use these devices as software-defined radios. We flash them or upload them with mesh firmware, and when we do that, they become a digital ham repeater that's capable of passing and routing digital data. It also allows us to connect clients to the mesh network based on having a built-in DHCP server. Each node then becomes a licensed ham radio station. That station is self-advertising. You plug in the power, it's advertising your call letters. It's self-discovering. It's looking for another mesh transceiver to link to. As two receivers come within RF range, they bind together and become a network. It's self-configuring. It figures out which digital mode to use for the particular signal conditions that it has to deal with at the time. The system, as a network, becomes fault-tolerant. If one of those mesh nodes goes down in the middle of a transmission, no problem. The system will automatically route the traffic around the dead node, and it'll find its way to its destination station. The magic of making this happen is achieved through a routing protocol called OSLR, Optimized Link State Routing Protocol, and that's the magic of the firmware that we upload. These nodes, once they're in the mesh network, can be controlled by each other using passwords, and the other beauty of the mesh nodes is that typically they're very low power, so if you want to power them with a battery, you know, a typical little scooter battery will keep the thing running for a day, a motorcycle battery for 3 days, about 7 watts, usually half that much. It works well with solar as well. One significant point that I want to make here is that mesh nodes only talk to other mesh nodes. So you're not going to enter the mesh network with the Wi-Fi on your cell phone or the Wi-Fi on your laptop. You can do that if we attach a Wi-Fi access point and hardwire it into the mesh, but that's the only way that you'll get in. So what we have here is a mesh network. It's a wireless, wide-area digital network. It's operating in the microwave ham bands, and I've shown those here. Two of these overlap the Wi-Fi frequencies, which is both a blessing and a curse. And we'll talk with you more about that at the booth. We're talking about a broadband signal. Now, those of you that are into digital ham communications, perhaps you're using FL Digi. We talk about broadband there, and you might be familiar with PSK31 at the narrow end of the spectrum, and maybe MSK63 at the high end, where you're a whole 3,000 hertz wide. Okay, here we're typically running 20 megahertz wide, and that allows us to transmit a very high-speed digital signal, typically 20 to 100 megabits per second wide. And we're doing that using standard TPC/IP protocol. In practice, a mesh network might look something like you see on the screen now. At the top of the screen, I've got a cluster of mesh nodes. They're all talking to each other. And I've hardwired to one of those a computer, an IPTV camera, and an analog telephone adapter, which allows me to use a plain old POTS telephone to plug into the mesh network. That cluster of mesh nodes at the top is also talking to a node at the top of a tower, which couples them to another mesh node at the bottom, another set of mesh stations or nodes talking to each other. Down there, I've got another telephone adapter with a telephone, a Raspberry Pi driving a widescreen TV monitor, a Wi-Fi access point, which allows access to the smartphone, and even an internet connection if I want to use that. So with this type of a configuration, you know, the video produced by the TV camera at the top can be viewed by the TV at the bottom. I can dial the IP address of the telephone at the top from the telephone at the bottom, and the phone at the top will ring. I can use the smartphone to view the video or to place calls as well. And if I choose to do so, I can propagate the internet across that mesh network. So how far apart can I put these nodes? Well, it kind of depends. How much power do I have? What's the antenna gain? What's the nature of the terrain? Do I have a clear line of sight? Do I have a clear Fresnel zone? If you look at the little picture there, the blue ellipse across the top is what they call the Fresnel zone. It's the area around the line of sight through which most of the RF energy of the transmitted signal is contained. You've got to keep that Fresnel zone clear of obstructions. If we allow those trees to penetrate the Fresnel zone, they're going to eat my signal. And those trees can eat 10 to 20 dB a piece of signal if I've got to pass through them. Atmospherics play a part of it. On a rainy day, if you've got poor conditions, the net will go down. Noise level is our biggest issue from co-channel Wi-Fi interference. Today we're running a great experiment that I'll mention. Our mesh network was working great this morning. If it's still working at 1 o'clock this afternoon, we will have achieved a miracle, because there will probably be about 6,000 noise sources, at least that, in the building by people walking in with Wi-Fi turned on their cell phones. Link quality is the big deal. Link quality we typically define as just the number of packets that make it through the system without having to be retransmitted. And when we talk about mesh, we talk about daisy chaining modes, and you would think, well, I could daisy chain between here and Cincinnati. No, because every time you daisy chain, you lose a certain percentage of the packets, unless you've got perfect link quality, and you never do. So you get into this 80% of 40% of 30% of 60% situation, and all of a sudden you have a link that's absolutely worthless. So mesh is not made for long-haul connections by daisy chaining. A typical mesh system then might look something like this. We've got at each location a handful of mesh clusters that are talking to each other at ground level or near ground level. And then we've got a 2.4 gigahertz node at the top of the tower that's serving as a linking point for all those units on the ground. And then between towers, that we've got 2.4 at the top of each tower, and the 2.4 could talk to each other, but that's typically going to be a weak link compared to what we can do in a much lower noise 5.8 gigahertz band, where we can have high gain antennas pointing at each other and have a very, very strong link joining the two mesh areas. And so we go hopping long distances, like 7 miles in Ohio over hilly terrain. We can get 7 mile links between towers, 70 foot ham towers, as long as we have a fairly clear line of sight, and we're using 5.8 and high gain antennas and high power. If all else fails, we can tunnel. The mesh firmware now includes a tunneling capability, and so if we want to join the mesh hams in Columbus and those in Cleveland and those in Dayton, we can tunnel to make that happen. I'm not going to talk about it a lot. If you have questions about tunneling, talk to us at our booth. Shown here are some pictures of a typical mesh systems. In the upper left-hand corner is a typical tactical node. We've got our Linksys router, a little TV camera, a battery, and a laptop. That's all that it requires. If you want to go long haul, the next picture to it shows a parabolic antenna on a building top, the third tripod on the ground. These are typical of what you might do, and the pictures of the towers in the lower left are some of the 70-foot style mesh installations that we've got on ham towers and commercial towers in the Dayton area. So consider the possibilities. What can you do with this thing? A mesh network, just like the network in your home, can serve as a host for computers, any kind of computer, Raspberry Pis, PCs, Macs, whatever you like. It will then support any kind of peer-to-peer communication utility. And peer-to-peer is becoming a big business. If you want peer-to-peer email, you can get it, because people, for some reason or other, don't trust their email in the cloud anymore. You can do peer-to-peer. You can handle all kinds of remote control applications and sensor systems. If you want to run Ham Radio Deluxe on mesh, you can do it. Any kind of computer-aided tuning, any kind of software-defined radio, you can control on the mesh network. You can have all kinds of server applications, file storage, web pages, relay chat. You can replicate servers. If you've got an emergency management agency that's got a server that they really value that they have on the internet, replicate it and put it on your mesh network, and when their power goes down and their server goes down, you've got that website available to them from your mesh site. You can stream video, cameras, cameras and trackers of all kinds. Voice over internet protocol telephones, Lin phone, PBX exchange. These are all systems that host conveniently on the mesh. GPS reporting. You can put in Wi-Fi access points if you want to and control it so that your served agencies or others can get into your mesh with their Wi-Fi cell phones. Lastly, if you want to, if you need to, you can propagate the internet, and there's a whole set of issues that I'll be happy to discuss with you at our booth at a later time. Other applications, ham radio projects, you know, any kind of SDR linking and control, contest logging systems. You want to have a motorcycle trip and link the motorcycles together on the trip, you can do it with mesh. You want to control the automation in your home, you can do it with mesh. If you want to serve, provide public service in your area, parades and races, do video coverage along the parade route. Log the runners as they pass by with a sensor, transmit that information on your mesh network. You got a classroom where kids want to watch what happens in the woods at night and what the animals really do. You can set up a camera in the woods at night and bring it back to the school and put it in the classroom on mesh. Fairs and festivals, you got a sheriff that would really like to have some surveillance that he otherwise can't do. Set up cameras, put the cameras on the mesh, and put some monitors at the sheriff's control station, and he'll know what's going on. The last thing I want to make here is that anymore, our served agencies in the emergency AMCOM world really rely on internet communication. They want their online search and data and documents and databases. They want email and Skype and all the other things that we're using in commercial business today, the social media. And unfortunately, in many cases, we as hams are asking them to fill out radiogram forms. We might even help them fill out the radiogram forms so that we can put them on the traffic system. If you see anything wrong with that picture, you might want to think about mesh, because I think mesh can fill that gap. With mesh, we can restore network services when they go down. We can replicate those services and databases and online maps and anything else that they might find necessary. We can provide high-speed tactical communications. You want to support search and rescue, you want to support drop a line of mesh nodes as you walk into fighting a fire, and so that the command post can see what the guys on the front lines are seeing, you can do that. You want to have surveillance on a chemical spill that no one wants to get close to, you can do that. You want to restore essential internet access during an emergency, you can do that too. Limitedly, you know, a limited amount of internet access for key providers. There are some supporting organizations that are making this happen, the people that are developing the firmware for mesh, supporting its deployment, telling you how and why, and giving you application examples and providing forums. The key organization here is Broadband Hamnet. Their website is shown, and we'll have more about them at the booth. There's a split off from that recently called Arden, and they're going down a slightly different technical development path, but again, supporting the same kind of system. And I mentioned before that we're running a grand experiment at Hamvention today. We've got about 22 nodes up at Hamvention. We've got nodes on the towers. We've got video links available that if you have a mesh node, you can tune into it. If it's still running this afternoon with all the other Wi-Fi interference, we will have achieved victory. Our strategy is power, proximity, and polarization. We'll talk to you more about that at the booth if you like. Shown here are the tactical nodes in the building. And I thank you for your time today. I'll turn the time now over to Bob Dixon, who has a demonstration that you'll probably find a whole lot more interesting than what I had to say. Thank you.
All right. In our public service work, people who we help are much more familiar with Wi-Fi type stuff than ham stuff. They're much more comfortable using cell phones, PCs, telephones, especially telephones that work in full duplex, unlike handing them a microphone so they have to do push to talk. And so we can marry Wi-Fi and radio and mesh in a way that I'm going to show you here in a moment. And we can get all these people talking to each other using all the devices that they're familiar with without making them do something in an artificial way which seems strange to them. And we can provide the infrastructure to make this happen. A cell phone is a ham radio transceiver. It receives and transmits in the 2400 megahertz ham band. So is a computer. And a telephone is certainly more convenient to normal people than just handing them a microphone and letting them talk. And mesh radio allows all these to talk together with normal ham radio equipment. We can make a Wi-Fi to mesh interconnect by having a mesh wireless router, a Wi-Fi wireless router, and connecting them together with an Ethernet cable. So that means that anybody can talk to anybody else in those two worlds. Say we can have somebody over here with a cell phone and somebody over here with a telephone on the mesh cloud, and they can talk to each other, and it's totally transparent. And this can be way far away on the mesh network, not just locally. We can also make a crossband repeater, where we have a mesh node here connected to a PC going through a TNC, running to a ham transceiver, which then goes to simplex or repeaters or whatever you would want to do. So that means that someone over here with a telephone in the mesh cloud could talk to someone over here on a local repeater or using a simplex frequency.
They want to tune their receivers to what frequency, Bob?
You might tune your HT to 146.46, and if we're lucky, we'll let you talk on the mesh in just a moment. Now, this is the combination. This little brown suitcase up here contains both of the two things I just talked about. It contains a radio crossband transmitter, or repeater, and a Wi-Fi to mesh conversion, so that everything can all talk to each other. Now, why would you rather use a cell phone instead of an HT? Well, because we can set the repeater up, the radio transmitter that's in the repeater, to be a high-power radio with a high antenna and higher in the air, higher power. So that means you could talk on your cell phone through that repeater and get much further than you could with your HT, assuming that you're not within range of the local repeater. The other advantage of a cell phone is it can send and receive live video, which is something that you can't do with your HT. We made some dedicated cell phones which have the necessary software built into it to do this, and we put a nice front page on it so it looks like this, and we can hand these cell phones to people and say, okay, do your thing. How this might be used, we could have a group of these dedicated cell phones out here connected to the mesh Wi-Fi radio transceiver, repeater, talking to their headquarters over here where they have a bunch of telephones, or they can be sending live video to this PC, which is displayed on a large screen video, so from the headquarters or the EOC, they can see what's happening out of the scene from any one of the cell phones that are out in the scene. This is all based, in our case, on the use of Lin phone software. This is a wonderful tool we recommend to everyone. It runs on all kinds of computers, PCs, cell phones. It provides audio and video and three-way calling. And actually, we have determined that it does far more than three-way calling. So you can have a whole group of people doing telephones, cell phones, and laptops, all talking to each other in a large group. And it also records everything, and you can do instant messaging. And it's free for you to download. The Lin Phone Software Cloud looks like this. We have all these different kinds of computers, all talking to each other, all communicate with all others, no internet, no service providers, no cell towers, no wires, and it's free. I also have here a mesh telephone suitcase, which is this blue suitcase that you see up here. It has in it four telephones. I call it my portable telephone company. It connects to the mesh, and you can make telephone calls from these telephones to anywhere else. The beauty of this is the telephones have a speed dial capability, so you would otherwise have to dial via IP address. But we program that IP address into all the telephones so that you just push a memory button and the call is placed to wherever you want to call. All right, I'd like to do some demonstrations for you. Uh-oh. Are you there? Okay. Now I'll demonstrate putting the cell people out of business here. I have to click on the green thing that appears.
Go ahead.
Okay. Are we there?
We're there.
Okay.
Hello. Hello?
Yes, I'm there. Are you?
We're here.
Okay, the microphone may not pick it up too well.
Speak. Talk again.
Okay, okay. I'm talking from my cell phone. You can hear it back there? Okay, so now, no cell towers here. We're just talking to each other. In fact, he could be on the other end of the mesh anywhere far away. And we can be talking back and forth with our cell phones. Okay. Now, if you have your HTs ready, you'll have to go over here and answer the call on that PC. This one. Oh. Is anybody hearing anything?
I'm trying to answer. Is that incoming call answer?
It timed out. I'll call again.
Here we go.
Okay. Using simplex now, but it could be whatever, you know, it could be through a repeater, whatever you want to do. Okay? Now I'm going to go to the Mac.
Okay, I'm now talking to the Mac. He can talk back and forth to me.
Hello.
Somebody else is on 4-6 over here. I wish
I'd
get them off the air.
Okay, so you see, I can now talk to the Mac. I can talk to a laptop anywhere. Or no. I'm starting video. We got the projector out. Are we on the air here?
We're on the air. We have a little bit of pixelization.
Okay, now. I can walk around anywhere.
I can walk around anywhere.
With my cell phone.
With my cell phone.
Head.
On my head.
And I can be sending live video and audio.
And audio.
Say from the scene of a disaster. Or from a place that I could give this to a fireman or someone else who could go into a hazardous area where I can't go. This can be sent from here back to the Emergency Operations Center or the headquarters, and they can see what's going on. So, I'm done. That's the end of our time. Thank you very much.
Okay, promise me one thing. When you make your pitch to the emergency coordinator in your county to give them video and stuff, that you won't wear a cell phone on your head. Probably not at any time, but especially not when you first start. Okay, that's the end of part one, and we'll be back in part two. We're going to see Brian Fields, W9CR. Brian is going to also be talking about a version of high-speed networking, a little bit different than what Bill and Bob were talking about. And then Chris Testa, KD2BMH, is going to update us on the progress of White Box, and I'll give you a hint. He's going to tell us that a board is just about ready for the public, almost ready. Don't tell him I told you that. And finally, Michael Osman, AD0NR, 60 days a ham, as he began that talk at that forum. And he'll be talking about spectrum monitoring on using software-defined radios for something way superior to the typical kind of pan adapter spectrum monitor that you've been used to. So that's coming up in part two. Let me just fade things out here, and part two will be coming right up.